So we've already noted the Law of Moses had three basic types of law: moral, ceremonial, and social. Let's break them down and look at them in a bit more detail, starting with the moral part of the law. Those who were led out of Egypt across the Sinai Desert towards their new piece of real estate had no real understanding of what absolute good looked like. Their relationship with God was still very new, and they had just come out of a pagan culture in Egypt, a culture whose demonic gods behaved like humans or worse, so they were used to being surrounded by immorality, and the Egyptian gods had given them no real insight into holiness or righteousness. And because the people had no real understanding of righteousness, they had no real understanding of their own sinfulness by comparison. To keep our analogy going, they didn't know the good apple to recognize that they were bad apples, and they didn't know the absolute light to recognize their own darkness. So the people of Israel were ignorant of their own sin. The purpose of the moral part of the Law of Moses then was to show them what absolute goodness looked like. It was designed to show them the good apple and to show them absolute light. It would explain to them that God was holier than they could ever have imagined. His moral standard or benchmark was beyond anything they had ever known or conceived of. It was infinite in its perfection. God told them, "This is who I am, and because I am this holy, you must be this holy too. Forget the standard you saw in Egypt and in the pagan cultures all around you. That was darkness compared to me. This is your standard. I am your standard." The people had seen nothing like it. This written moral revelation dramatically revealed the massive gulf that existed between God's standard of goodness and the people's standard of goodness. Isaiah vividly describes the chasm by saying that next to God's white-hot holiness and stunning purity, our own goodness suddenly looks like filthy rags, in much the same way that looking at a midday sky suddenly makes even a 4 a.m. sky look very dark. God's holiness exposed their own sin. In fact, so high and so perfect was this new moral standard that there was simply no way a sinful human being could ever keep it. The Law of Moses didn't just reveal that man was a bit short of God's standard and needed to do better. It revealed that man was completely and utterly morally bankrupt before a God whose standards he just couldn't keep, no matter how hard he tried. Man was separated from God by an impassable chasm of sin. He was without hope. For example, the Ten Commandments told them that they could never lie. Ever. And there is not a single human being who has ever gone a lifetime without lying. In fact, there's barely a human that goes a week without lying. The Ten Commandments also demanded that no one ever steal or dishonor their parents or become envious of their neighbors. Well, these are things that humans do. We just do. All humans have lied and stolen and been envious and gone against their parents. As the Bible rightly says, "For everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard." We just can't help it. It's part of our sinful nature inherited from Adam and Eve. In fact, humanity has become a byword for imperfection. Quite often our defense when we do something wrong is, "I can't help it, I'm only human," which is to say, "I can't help it, I'm only imperfect." Now that's a problem when God is looking for moral perfection, saying, "Be holy because I am holy." What makes all this worse is that God explained to the people that if anyone broke his law, the punishment was death. You see, God is so absolutely pure that not a scrap or shred or even an atom of sin can exist unpunished. If even the smallest speck of sin remained unpunished in his universe, God would no longer be perfect himself and would no longer be God. As a perfect and holy judge, God must destroy it. Remember, we heard that Satan and things consecrated to him have been set apart for destruction. All sin, even the tiniest part, is set apart for destruction by God, and so anyone that sins must die. People often think that a good God would never send anyone to hell, but it's exactly his goodness that means he must send people to hell. God's goodness doesn't let you off the hook, it keeps you on the hook. Imagine if a judge found a man guilty of a savage murder but then let him go unpunished. Would that be a good judge or a corrupt judge? It would be a corrupt judge, of course. A good judge would see that justice was served. So the judge's goodness actually makes him dangerous to the criminal. And it's the same with God. His goodness and holiness means justice must be served and all sin must be destroyed. And all this means that if you have sinned, and you have, he must destroy you. Justice and holiness demands it. God's goodness makes him dangerous to us. If you've ever lied, you're a liar, and God has to destroy liars. If you've ever stolen, you're a thief, and God must destroy thieves. That illegal MP3 file you downloaded, that bit of chocolate you took from the refrigerator that belonged to someone else, when you did those things, you broke the moral law, and the punishment for all such sin is death. It is stunning holiness. And without this holiness, there would be no hope for the world. If God didn't destroy all evil, there would be no end of evil in the universe or in man's heart. There could be no heaven. If God didn't judge evil in this way, then heaven would be filled with prisons, hatred, violence and fear, just like this earth is, and it would cease to be heaven and God would cease to be God. Evil must end. Weeping and tears must end. Hatred and sorrow must end. And to end it, evil must be judged and consequently destroyed. As much as we don't want to be on the receiving end of the punishment, we know it's God's goodness that demands it must happen. The punishment for our wrongdoing is death, and rightly so. A.W. Tozer wrote, "The vague and tenuous hope that God is too kind to punish the ungodly has become a deadly opiate for the consciences of millions." He also rightly said, "We cannot grasp the true meaning of the divine holiness by thinking of someone or something very pure and then raising the concept to the highest degree we are capable of. God's holiness is not simply the best we know infinitely bettered. We know nothing like the divine holiness. It stands apart, unique, unapproachable, incomprehensible, and unattainable. The natural man is blind to it. He may fear God's power and admire his wisdom, but his holiness he cannot even imagine. In fact, God's perfect holiness is so dangerous to imperfect beings like ourselves that when he was preparing to give Moses the Ten Commandments, he warned the people to set up a perimeter around the base of the mountain and not to let anyone go past it. He told them that if any sinful human being went through the perimeter and came into contact with God's holiness as his presence rested on the mountain, they would instantly die, a bit like a fly hitting an electric fly killer. Later on, a man called Uzzah unfortunately experienced this truth when he touched the Ark of the Covenant where God's presence resided by mistake and instantly dropped dead. This kind of perfect purity was stunning to the people. It struck them with fear and awe. They had never witnessed anything like it. And God was asking them to be that perfect too? Impossible. The people of Israel had problems.